Does BMX geometry matter? That's the topic of discussion in today's Tuesday Tip, and with that, I don't want to give a blanket generalization statement one way or the other, because I know plenty of people who have been riding for 10 plus years that feel that no, it doesn't, and some that feel yes, it does. What I want to talk about in this video are the subtle nuances of BMX geometry and how they may or may not affect the feel of your bike, doing certain tricks with parts of certain geometries, and how that can potentially affect the way your bike feels or the ease of certain tricks, or maybe it doesn't. And the TLDR on this one is, if you're brand new to BMX or you're just learning, the geometry of parts like your forks and the offset on your fork is not going to matter quite as much as it might to someone who's been riding for 10 years and wants to do specific nose manual tricks that a fork offset might actually affect, or someone who rides specifically only trails and wants to build a bike that is meant for staying low and going fast through the trails and being stable on big dirt jumps. So that being said, let's get into this one and discussing some nuances of BMX geometry. And with that, I feel that throughout the years, BMX has kind of settled on a geometry range that works for what we do. In the very beginning, bikes were just the bikes that people made to cruise around on, and people were doing tricks on them because we were discovering what BMX was. And throughout time, BMX bikes were breaking because they weren't built sturdy enough. So then they got overbuilt and the geometry of them started to change. And then as things progressed on, we've gone from one extreme to the other. BMX frames specifically got super, super small and light as far as the tubing goes, and then they started to break, so we scaled it back. And all the while we've been doing this, we've been just changing up handlebar height, fork offset, all of these different things that have changed throughout the years of BMX, and we've kind of gotten to where we're at today and where a lot of people feel that geometry affects certain things in BMX. And I have videos on literally pretty much every single part on the bike and the geometry, and I talk very in depth about how these things affect certain things in BMX or how maybe they don't. Crank length is a very, very highly debated one of those, and the video on that goes in depth on that. So I'm not gonna go crazy with this, but I wanna give you guys kind of the gist of these things, and if you wanna learn more, you can check out the other videos on these things. Speaking on BMX bikes from the past, when we look back to a time where people like Matt Hoffman were inventing the craziest tricks ever on a regular basis, and look at the bikes that they were riding, bikes that were legitimately 40 and 50 pounds, and by today's standards, not made to the geometry that we've come to know as specific for a certain type of riding. So that's a perfect case for the example of maybe BMX geometry doesn't matter quite as much as sheer willpower to land a trick does. And I know plenty of people who are riding bikes in situations that they weren't made for by today's standards. And that's a great case for that example that maybe sometimes BMX geometry doesn't matter as much as some people feel like it might. Now, it's not to say that you shouldn't feel like it might matter to you, or that what you feel when you're riding when you change parts isn't real. I'm not delegitimizing any of that by any means. I'm just suggesting for some of the people out there who feel like I have to have this certain frame geometry or I'm not gonna be able to do this trick, that your mind power is probably more important than your frame size. But on that note, let's talk about frame geometry, because there are certainly things that can have an impact and that people do change for certain situations. And we can compare that with modern day BMX street and park frames versus the geometry that is ideal for trail riding. When it comes to a BMX trails bike, we can often see a lower bottom bracket height as well as a more mellow head tube. So this head tube is mellowed out. We see less offset in the forks, which also mellows those out. When it comes to handlebars and stem geometry, I'm not entirely sure there, but when it comes to that frame geometry, we can think about this lower bottom bracket in kind of a sense of, when we think about Jenga, for example, the taller you build a Jenga tower, the more the more sway you get at the top of it. So the higher you stand on the bike and the higher you are off of something, the more your balance and your center of gravity has an impact on what you're doing. So if you lower that bottom bracket height, it puts your feet lower, it lowers your center of gravity, which it essentially can make you feel more stable, which is why a lot of trail frames have that lower bottom bracket. Then when you talk about the head tube angle and the fork offset, the goal there is to mellow out the front end, because when the front end is more mellow, that means that your turning has less of an impact immediately. It takes more to have the same impact that a less offset might have, which in turn also makes things more stable, which is something that a lot of people like for trail riding. When you compare that to a modern day street or park frame, the bottom bracket height's a little bit higher. You've got a short back end. This is something we also need to talk about with trail geometry. And you've got a steep front end. The steep front end allows things for like bar spins and tail whips because it's more steep and that turning has more of an effect. And that frame coming around at that specific angle, it can be faster. That steepened head tube angle and fork offset gives you more of a reactionary turning on the bike, which is sometimes ideal for things like nose manuals or grinds to spins and just spinning in general. Same with a shorter bike. The closer your wheel offset is together, the more agile your bike is going to feel, because the closer your wheels are together, when you turn, you're going to turn quicker. Things are going to happen faster. And the opposite of that happens with a longer frame, with a mellower head tube, mellower fork offset, with a longer rear end. The rear end on a trails oriented frame is a little bit longer as well, because the idea there is also to have a longer wheelbase so that you feel more stable going through the trails. Having a more reactionary, twitchier bike riding through the trails isn't something that a lot of trail people like whenever they're riding. But that's another example of a personal preference. It's personal choice, and there are plenty of people out there who ride absolutely amazing with a park orientated or street orientated frame, fork, and rear end length and all of that in the trails. So moving on from there, let's talk specifically about the geometry of the fork. We talked a little bit about how the offset can affect the stability of the bike and the control and the feel of control while turning, but there's also the control of tricks like nose manuals with a steeper offset. That steeper offset and that more control can make you feel like you have more of a quicker control in a nose manual and front end tricks to make it feel like those are easier. And there are certainly people out there who feel that that offset affects their nose manual tricks, hence the existence of the range in these Odyssey R forks, the R15s, the R25s, and the R32s. They all exist for a reason, and they wouldn't exist if it was all in your head. So you guys can kind of see where I'm leaning when it comes to frame geometry, but I will talk about my personal preferences at the end as well. So now let's talk about something like the stem, because the stem is actually something that I feel a lot of people don't put a lot of thought into, but it can have a big impact on how your bike feels. And that's another case for an example of BMX geometry and how it may or may not affect the feel of your riding, because I feel a lot of people don't even put thought into their stem and the geometry behind that as far as the reach goes. A lot of people talk about the rise of their stem because they know that that raises up the bars and there's certain things to do with that. But when it comes to the reach, there's impacts of that potentially that you may feel that you might not have even thought about. So the reach of your stem, if you look directly here, is how far away your bars go from the center of the steer tube on your fork. And a longer reach, when you think about this logically and physically, a longer reach puts your handlebars further away. And whenever you spin the bars, when they're further away from the fork, that means that you have more centripetal force going around. It takes more to get them going, but in the same sense, it also means that it's gonna be slower because it takes more to get it to go around. And it also means that it's gonna have more of a wobbling effect on your bike because it's further away. And you can think about that with something like when you watch someone like a figure skater. Their arms are out, they bring their arms closer together, and the closer together they get, the faster they start spinning. It's similar to that. your arms are further out is like having your bars further away. But there's an impact on control with this as well. Because it puts it further away, that means that it takes more to do the same turn of your handlebars, the way we already explained, but in the impact on steering. So a shorter stem not only could potentially make your bar spins feel faster because they're closer to the fork and it takes less and they can spin faster easier, it also can have an impact on your turning. And this is something that could potentially affect your nose manuals, for example, just like we talked about with the forks. But since there's so many people out there who don't even think about this impact, maybe it's something that's negligible and it's just in the head of the people who think about these things. Let me know your guys' thoughts on these as we go through them in the comments down below, because I'm of the camp that I feel certain geometric differences can make a big difference, but not on the micro scale of things. I don't think a 52 millimeter reach stem versus a 53 millimeter reach stem is something that I personally could feel while riding my bike, but there are people out there who do feel like that. So now let's talk about the rise of the stem. This is literally just how much it raises up your handlebars. You can do the exact same thing with the rise of your handlebars itself. But when we talk about lifting our handlebars up, let's think about what that might do or impact on our bike. The first and big thing that people talk about is lower back pain. If you think about what lower handlebars means, if your handlebars are lower, that means you're slouched over more than if they were higher, where you'd be standing more straight up. And just doing this, you can feel the difference between the comfort of standing and the comfort of slouching over and the effect that might have on lower back pain. And this is something that I've felt myself. So that's one that I feel we can definitively say that a taller handlebar is going to make you have less back pain than a lower handlebar will. And when we talk about handlebar geometry itself, there's also the upsweep and the back sweep. These are all things that impact where your hands are at and how much angle there are. So the back sweep affects the angle your hands go this way, and the upsweep affects the angle your hands go this way. And these are things that, admittedly, I don't know how much they affect tricks on your bike or how much they could potentially affect it. And I feel like this is kind of a comfort measurement for people. I'm sure that there's some kind of effect that these differences can have on something like a tail whip where your hands are like this and it makes it easier. I don't entirely know about that one. I would not be inclined to believe that it would be so much of an effect that I would have to have a very specific handlebar geometry versus what's just comfortable for me and comfortable for my hands when riding. And now I feel we talked about all these things, and you can watch the in-depth videos to go over the real deep nuances of all of these things, because there's a lot to it. We can talk about the cranks. The length of your cranks is totally up to you whether or not you think it has an impact. And I would just suggest to watch that video because there's so much to talk about with this. But essentially the idea here is that the longer crank you have, the more torque you can generate when pedaling, but the force it takes to do it. Shorter crank you have, the less torque you'll actually have with the same amount of force, but it takes force to get it going. There's also the effect on your feet hitting your pegs. If you're a taller person with bigger feet, then a longer crank length might mean that you're constantly hitting your pegs with your feet, which is a very big deal for a lot of people who actually have to deal with that. So I want to make sure I talk about that too. But these differences are things that are mathematical. They matter quite a lot for people in racing. But when it comes to BMX freestyle, it's one of those things that I feel is personal preference and entirely personal preference. So we've talked about most of these different aspects of geometry, and when you boil it down, what are these things doing? They're essentially just changing where the different contact points of your body are with your bike and how your bike feels as far as wheelbase goes and where your axles are at on the bike. So they're changing, making your wheelbase shorter, making your feet lower or higher with that bottom bracket height, making them closer or further away to your front end and your back end, and it's changing where they sit as far as between that goes. They're changing where your hands are at with shorter bars, with a different upsweep or backsweep in a shorter stem, your hands are in different points in space. And when you break it down that way and think about how radically different your body positioning can be and your bike positioning and certain parts positioning can be on your bike with different geometry, it's hard to say that it doesn't matter at all and that it doesn't affect things. There's certain things that I've noticed that I feel like definitely have an impact. But then we look at people like my buddy Trevor, who normally rides a 19.5 inch top tube with 25 offset forks and whatever other parts he rides, but he will jump on anyone else's bike and do all of his tricks with ease. There's certain things that can become more difficult with a longer frame for him, and he's said that before, but for the most part, he'll jump on anyone's bike and do anything he can do very easily. And there's certain outliers like that who just don't care, and that is where the sheer willpower and mind power, I feel, comes into play over BMX geometry. But before we go, I will give you guys my personal outlook on BMX geometry. When we look at the different parts that I have, I pretty much have the most generic geometry that you can get on a bike right now. 175 millimeter length cranks, R32 forks with that 32 millimeter offset, a Sunday Soundwave frame, which is pretty much as generic as it gets between trails and modern street frame geometry. I've got a stem with 33 millimeters of rise and 53 millimeters of reach, and then handlebars that are 9.5 with 10 and 2 in backsweep and upsweep. So it's pretty much as generic as it gets because I'm of the mindset that I want to feel comfortable riding anything that I'm riding on, whether it's riding street and doing whatever in the street or going to the trails or riding a skate park. I want my bike to feel comfortable in all of those situations. So I got something that was as middle of the road as I possibly can. So no matter where I'm going, no matter what I might want to ride, I'm gonna feel comfortable. And that's the mindset that I have on it. But the beautiful thing about freestyle is you can do whatever you want to. You can set your bike up however you want to. You can take that modern day street geometry frame and bike to the trails and ride it just the same as anyone who's there with a trails specific geometry bike. And I see people do it all the time, being that I help dig and ride a lot at local trails to me. So let's leave it there. Let me know what you guys think about all of this in the comments down below. It's a very long-winded subject, but I feel it's worth discussing. And for the people who are new to BMX, who watch this and take in this information and learn about it here before they actually experience it and learn about it there so they have an idea of what's coming, I feel it may be helpful. So if it is, also let me know that in the comments down below. And if you guys are new here or you haven't yet, hit the subscribe button while you're down there, and hopefully that'll mean that we'll see you tomorrow for another one. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you then. Goodbye.